chief of security. Exterminate all man animals at will.
The alien race named the Cyclos tries to exterminate the human race in Battlefield Earth, one of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Richard Roper, columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times.
Our first movie is an unholy mess named Battlefield Earth. Let's not beat around the bush. This is one of the ugliest and most incomprehensible movies I've ever seen. It's like spending 2 hours in the intergalactic town dump with a lot of people who need a bath and a trip to the dentist. The movie stars John Travolta in a role that obscures and wastes his talent as a creature named Turl, security chief of the alien Cyclos. Forrest Whitaker is second in command, meets Turl's new secretary, played here by Kelly Preston.
She's stupid enough not to be a menace, good-looking enough to be decorative. She gets drunk with economical speed.
And has other advantages.
Barry Pepper plays Johnny Good Boy Tyler, the heroic leader of the humans who've been almost wiped out, maybe because they make inexplicable and dumb decisions like this one.
Surely someone as wise as you has ways to stop me from shooting. I know that if I had tried, you would have killed me first.
Damn right, rat brain. That's the first intelligent thing you've said yet.
Just look at the visuals here. The whole movie is grungy and depressing, and the fate of two entire planets are decided by characters who think they won't seem clueless if they just shout loud enough. There's just no joy in Battlefield Earth. This movie is not fun. I think, although I'm not sure, that the movie thinks the extreme stupidity of Turl is amusing. I mean, here's one of the leaders of a conquering race, and he doesn't even know what kind of food humans eat. Travolta is a charming actor, but not here, not as Turl, hiding behind a sneer, a lot of hair, and those weird nose tubes. The movie is based on a novel by L. Ron Hubbard, the founder of Scientology, but as nearly as I can determine, it contains no examples of Scientology or any other system of thought. Just a lot of unpleasant creatures scowling at one another.
They have those tubes because their careers are going to be on life support if they keep doing movies like this. Remember the Commodores, Lionel Richie and those guys? That's what Travolta's dressed like. Now, they're supposed to be like 9 feet tall, but really, they just have really big boots, so they have to walk kind of slowly. It doesn't matter. Why do they look like that? It's got nothing to do with the story. Nothing's consistent in this story. Sometimes people are smart. Sometimes they're stupid. Sometimes they can figure things out. Sometimes they can't.
But no matter which it is, it's always unpleasant to look at. This is
really
one of really the ugliest movies I've seen. And also, the computer-generated effects. Last week we reviewed Gladiator. This week we're reviewing this film with lots of computer-generated effects. And if you go back to the old-fashioned kinds of special effects, for example, John Carpenter's Escape from New York. New York looks so much better in that movie than Denver looks in this movie.
So all the technology and all the money and all the star power in the world, and you've got one of the ugliest, most depressing, dank movies we've ever seen.
It's just everything looks like it has a fungus growing on it.
Truly awful, truly awful. Okay, our next movie is Michael Jordan to the Max, starring the biggest superstar in the world on the biggest screens in the world, IMAX and OmniMax. Now, forget about larger than life. He's just plain huge here. Now, if God himself appeared in the sky, I don't think his image would be much larger, nor would he get a more reverential treatment than Jordan receives in this wet kiss of a documentary, which chronicles his final championship year with the Chicago Bulls.
That may have been the last shot Michael Jordan will ever take in the NBA. If that's the last image of Michael Jordan,
as for Michael the Man, much of what we hear is like an outtake from a Nike commercial.
Somewhere there's a kid working. He won't skip any steps. He will learn from my example just as I've learned from others. There will be a player much greater than me.
But at least one superfan has a sense of humor about his airness.
You figure that's been, I don't know, 25,000 years. I don't know how you do the math of that, but that's like out of all the 50,000 top athletes since, you know, prehistoric time, brontosaurus and pterodactyls included, he's right there.
And you know, it's just plain frightening to see anyone's head inflated to a height of 4 stories. Now, I was lucky enough to see Michael Jordan play dozens of times, and I've seen him many times off the court as well. And you know what? He doesn't talk like he does in this movie. He's a more complicated person than the airbrushed version you see on TV and in this movie. I expected Michael Jordan to the Max to give us something beyond a super big screen version of ESPN highlights. I hope there'd be some new fresh insights into this very famous but still mysterious man. But that didn't happen, so I'm giving this thumbs down.
I'm giving a thumbs down, too. This is like an NBA promotional film. This is like the authorized, official, standard version of Michael Jordan. It's like a promotion for Michael Jordan, the product. And even the talking heads that they have come on all sound rehearsed and scripted, and they tell us things. We know, we've heard this thousands
of times. So many times before.
He works harder than anyone else. He wants to win more than anyone else.
He's a good basketball player.
He's the greatest
basketball
player who ever lived. And it goes on and on. We've heard it. We've heard it. We know it by heart. We want to know. Either we want to know something about Michael Jordan, which I don't think we're ever going to get.
Yeah.
Because that wall of privacy is there. Or we want to see some great basketball footage. I would have rather seen 45 minutes from the last game of the last playoff than 45 minutes of this, which is just, as you say, ESPN highlights.
Yeah, and, you know, the IMAX, we expect so much more from them, and maybe because they had to stay on the sidelines. Obviously, they can't be out on the courts showing it from Jordan's point of view. We expected something different from them. I remember seeing documentaries about the Packers and the Cowboys in the 70s that were more insightful than this.
Well, this is not a documentary film. This is a promotional film. It's like a 45-minute commercial.
You could substitute the word Jesus for Jordan in throughout this movie, and it would work. That's how reverential it is.
Okay, coming up later in the show, Kevin Spacey and Danny DeVito, our salesmen, intent on landing the big Kahuna.
He's honest.
Oh, well, that is a problem.
Coming up next, Ethan Hawke in a modern version of Hamlet.
Where is Polonius?
In heaven.
Speak. I'm bound to hear.
I am thy father's spirit. Doomed for a certain term to walk the night. I could a tale unfold whose lightest word would harrow up thy soul.
Hamlet learns of murder most foul from the ghost of his father in that scene from a modern version of Shakespeare's tragedy set in New York City. Ethan Hawke plays Hamlet. Sam Shepard was his father there. And the plot revolves around a hostile takeover of the Denmark Corporation. Kyle MacLachlan plays Claudius, Hamlet's stepfather, who has seized the corporation and married Hamlet's mother with unseemly haste. Although the props and settings are present day, all of the dialogue is Shakespeare's own. Ophelia is played by Julia Stiles, and here Hamlet toys with her.
You are merry, my lord.
Oh, God, what should a man do but be merry? But look you how cheerful my mother looks, and my father died within 2 hours.
Nay, 'tis twice 2 months, my lord.
So long? Nay, then, let the devil wear black, for I'll have a suit of sables. Oh, heavens, died 2 months ago and not forgotten yet.
Quiet and touching comic relief comes from Bill Murray as Polonius, a corporate executive who has the ear of Claudius and his wife, Gertrude.
What might you or my dear majesty here think if I had looked upon this love with idle sight? What might you think? No, I went round to work, and my young mistress, thus I did bespeak. Lord Hamlet is a prince out of thy star. This must not be.
Diane Benora is Gertrude, who in this version seizes Hamlet's goblet of wine because he realizes Claudius has tampered with it.
Hamlet, take my napkin. Rub thy brows. The queen carouses to thy fortune, Hamlet.
I've seen Hamlet done in every possible style except as a cartoon by South Park, and the play often seems impervious to any possible experiment. Ethan Hawke plays Hamlet as a convincingly introverted nerd, using computers, videos, and even a pixel vision camera to examine his motives and to look into his soul, and the movie shows imagination in how it uses those modern settings. It doesn't compare with Kenneth Branagh's great 1996 Hamlet, but it's not really intended to. In its own way, it's surprisingly effective.
Yeah, I like this movie a lot. I like the approach to it. You mentioned Ethan Hawke, who I think is a little bit more Hamlet's age than some of these other performances. Even Olivier was like, I don't know, was he 45 or something? His dad would have died of old age if he hadn't been murdered. But I like what Ethan Hawke did in this movie. I thought the supporting cast was great. Bill Murray is terrific, once again proving that he's a lot better actor than he gets credit for, and the different visual styles. And it takes a lot of guts to have everybody speak in the original language from that Bill Shakespeare guy, who I think has a real future as a screenwriter, and to do it in modern-day New York. So
you know, Shakespeare does
really
have a future.
Terrific.
Shakespeare does have a future because there are all these Shakespeare movies coming out now. Love's Labour's Lost comes out later in the year. There was a modern dress Romeo and Juliet a couple of years ago that I did not like nearly as much as I like this Hamlet.
How about the Claire Danes one?
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah.
Because I think that they were really trying to make it too hip and trying to almost condescend to the audience.
Yeah.
This movie makes it very clear that Shakespeare is the author of this material, and by setting it in New York, they just bring a new spin on it.
You don't have
to
mess
really
with the words. The words are pretty good on there.
You got it.
Okay, coming up next, we've got Kevin Spacey and Danny DeVito, who are desperate salesmen in the Big Kahuna.
Smell it? Business in the air. Do you smell it?
It's the kind of air that makes account ledgers grow.
Well, there's only one account ledger that matters to us tonight.
Well, we're going to get that one, too. You watch.
Kevin Spacey and Danny DeVito are industrial lubricant salesmen who have come to Wichita in the hopes of landing a lucrative account. I guess that would be a lucrative lubricant account in the Big Kahuna, a play adapted to film that looks like a play adapted to film. Spacey is the sardonic Larry, and DeVito plays his bone-tired old friend Phil. They're a couple of road warriors who have spent most of their adult lives putting on name tags and glad-handing more successful people and using every trick in the book to sell more lubricant. On this mission, they're joined by a bright-eyed rookie who's played by Peter Facinelli.
You're here to represent research, technical support, the brains of the company.
Me? Absolutely. Oh, but I don't have that much experience.
Oh, well, that doesn't matter. You as a person don't really matter, Bob. It's what you represent.
There are a lot of stagey scenes like that in the crummy hotel suite, as when Phil contemplates his future.
I've been toying with the idea of pursuing a different line of work.
Well, speaking as your friend, Phil, as one who knows you intimately, as it were, I think that's a bad idea. Dare I say, an entirely shoddy idea.
Why?
Well, because A, you were born for this. You have a gift. And B, I don't exactly relish the idea of going out in the road with somebody new.
It's gonna happen sooner or later.
No, it wasn't. I was always hoping we'd end in a kind of murder-suicide thing.
Nobody does sly sarcasm like Kevin Spacey, and DeVito has some wonderful moments as a character who has traded in his salesman's desperation for something approaching quiet dignity. But Facinelli as the rookie is like a bat boy trying to play ball with a couple of Hall of Famers, and I felt the Big Kahuna finally would sink under the weight of its pretentious script and the unimaginative direction. The attempts to move the action out of the hotel room really aren't worth the trouble, and the dialogue is strictly Glengarry Glen Light. I'd rather spend a night in Wichita than sit through the Big Kahuna again.
Boy, I love this movie. I really did. And I loved all three of the performances. I think Facinelli is supposed to be kind of the green rookie. And what's fascinating here is he's accepted Jesus as his personal savior. That's the whole gimmick. And these two guys are sitting up there. They've accepted industrial lubricants as their personal saviors. And they're kind of up against a blank wall trying to talk to this guy who would rather talk to the Big Kahuna about Jesus than about industrial lubricants. There's just nothing they can say to him, and so they're talking to each other. Now, it is a play. Mm-hmm. It is a play, and it's a film play, and I accept that. I don't expect that they're going to go out and have a camera racing around the streets of Wichita. I like the fact that it's one step because the dialogue and the performances are the key, and Spacey and DeVito, who are together on screen together for so long, are both intrinsically fascinating actors.
I don't mind if a play stays, you know, true to itself when it's adapted for a movie, but the dialogue was just way too stagey for me, way too mannered. You could just see them getting their big speeches together. Yeah, Kevin Spacey's really good, and Danny DeVito I liked a lot. I didn't think the kid was very good at all, and nothing happened in this movie that surprised me at all. It just sort of followed its course.
No, it doesn't.
See the three characters, and I think they're all supposed to be the same character at different points in their lives, and we kind of get that. They're very obvious and overstated with that. And by the time it was over, I just wished I had left Wichita on an earlier plane.
Well, on the other hand, nothing surprised me in Hamlet either, because I knew how it was going to turn out. It's actually just...
That's not true, because they did it in
texture,
a different way in Hamlet.
Here, the texture of how the dialogue goes past, and the fact that it's a little mannered and a little literate and a little carefully written, to me, adds to the interest. I don't want it all to be vernacular.
I didn't care that much about any of the three characters.
Okay, next movie is Center Stage, a movie that's about young students at the fictional American Ballet Company in New York, and it stars some of the most talented young dancers in the country, or in the world right now. The story takes them through their first year of training and into the auditions that will decide their futures. But first, there's a lot of backstage stuff, including, of course, a lot of young romance. Ethan Stifel, a real-life superstar, plays Cooper, the star of the company, who lures a young student, played by Amanda Scholl, to his apartment.
I couldn't take my eyes off you tonight. Best I could do. Cheers.
Sasha Radetzky plays his rival for her affections, and during a rehearsal, they try to top one another.
Why don't you just try this?
I could work on it.
You do that.
And the movie ends with the ballets we've seen in rehearsal, including this one choreographed in part to Michael Jackson's the way you make me feel. I like the fact that most of the roles were played by real dancers, and I like the observant detail in the scenes where they were rehearsing and discussing their craft and doing what is really basically very hard work. And I just plain admire them for their art and grace. The two final ballets are the best music and dance I've seen in a feature film for a long time, so sure, the story is a little obvious and shallow, but the movie works, and I liked it.
I liked it better than you did. I thought it was tremendous. And, of course, you know, I am Mr. Ballet. So, I mean, if it gets somebody like me to enjoy it. But I like the fact that it didn't shy away from questions like when they see a good-looking male dancer, someone says gay or straight. Mm-hmm. They talked about bulimia and body image and all that stuff. And they also reminded us that ballet dancers are unbelievable athletes. And like any other types of athletes, they push their bodies to limits that probably aren't healthy, and they really work themselves into a frenzy. And you're right, the last two numbers are terrific. They tricked us. They made us watch a bunch of ballet in this movie and care about it.
You know, what I really appreciated about this film is that for a year or two now, we've been getting practically the prom movie of the week.
Right.
You know, who's going to go to the senior prom?
Yeah.
Movies about kids who are more or less in this age group and who are stupid and who have no goals.
Dimwits.
And who are dimwits. And here we have bright, ambitious kids who are really pushing the limits of their abilities and still are kids. They still go out to a club. They still get drunk.
Right.
Yeah, they still smoke too many cigarettes.
And they get excited about boys or girls or whatever the case may be, and they get involved in petty things, but the dance is the thing.
They have goals and they're people.
Yeah,
okay, when we come back, my video pick this week is an overlooked film by the great master Martin Scorsese. My video pick this week is an extraordinary film. To copy John Cusack and High Fidelity, is one of the top five films of 1999. But somehow it got overlooked at the box office, and I don't know why. Any film by Martin Scorsese is an important event, and Bringing Out the Dead was dark and powerful and filled with emotion. It starred Nicolas Cage as a paramedic with an emergency response team in the Hell's Kitchen District of New York. He's being ground down by this job.
I had to concentrate to keep my mind from wandering off on these short trips. It was the neighborhood I grew up in, and where I'd worked most as a paramedic, and it held more ghosts per square foot than any other.
Patricia Arquette plays a woman who has just lost her father, and the Cage character finds a resource of hidden tenderness.
They just moved him to the second floor to ICU.
He coded. They shocked him too many times. I'm sorry.
But most nights disappear in a blur of urgency and chaos.
Thank you, Jesus.
Are you all right?
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
That is the last time you do this to me, Martin.
There's an underlying spiritual level in Bringing Out the Dead. I think there's supposed to be a little of Jesus Christ in the paramedic, the same Christ who almost despaired as he was hanging on the cross. But as in all Scorsese movies, there was also laughter and joy, amazing supporting performances, and ceaseless kinetic energy. Bringing Out the Dead was one of the best films of last year, and it's my video pick of the week. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this week's show. Two thumbs down, way down, way, way down, way, way, way down for the horrendous Battlefield Earth, wasting John Travolta and a lot of film stock. Two more thumbs down for Michael Jordan to the Max, which plays like an NBA promotional film. Two thumbs up, though, for a cutting-edge modern version of Hamlet starring Ethan Hawke. A split vote for The Big Kahuna starring Kevin Spacey and Danny DeVito. I like the sharp humor and insights Richard found it pretentious and stagey. And finally, two thumbs up for Center Stage, a sweet and smart, if predictable, charmer that's set in the ballet world.
Well, we've got to remember one thing. No matter what, don't go see Battlefield Earth. Stay away.
I think that
it's
would be
real the real Phantom Menace.
It's probably the most useful lesson to take home from this show. Remember, you can hear our reviews, Richard and myself, at Ebert-Movies.com, and my print reviews and Richard's column are at sometimes.com. Next week, more new movies, including the animated feature Dinosaur, and also Shanghai Noon, starring Jackie Chan. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.